It's kind of crazy because, you know, playing at Brewster and being like a top player in Canada, everyone was expecting you to go to like a Duke or something or a Syracuse.
Right.
So I remember you spoke, you had to make some grown man decisions.
Right.
So like what went into you choosing to go to a college closer to the border rather than one of those high major schools?
Right, yeah, so going to Brewster, you know, I think nine of us went D1. I wanna say nine players got a scholarship. And everyone, you know, went high major. and I had some high major offers as well, you know, having a good season there. I think I hit the game winner in the championship game for the NEPSAC.
Wow.
We won the national championship, like I said. So everyone was getting big time looks at the time. but right around that time, I would say halfway through my time in high school at Brewster, I was having my daughter. And she was going to be born in September.
Today we have another special guest from Toronto who did a lot for the community, a lot for the basketball community. It goes by the name of Ashton Khan. So I just want to appreciate you coming out here today, bro.
Man, thank you for having me, bro. Appreciate
no problem. So let's get right into it, bro. So you grew up in Scarborough.
Yep, grew up in Scarborough.
What was it like growing up out there?
Growing up in Scarborough, you know, has its pros and cons, you know. Growing up in certain neighborhoods, you get close with your friends.
Yeah.
I know, so you have a tight-knit group of friends. And, you know, it's a benefit that we all play basketball, so we all grew up playing a sport, and it helps us, like, stick together. But then, obviously, you have your tough part, you know, with it not being maybe the best neighborhood to grow up in. So they have that, you know, that part to deal with growing up, but I wouldn't change it for anything. It kind of made me who I am today, so it was a blessing.
No, 100%, bro, 100%. So, like, who got you started with basketball?
I would say my older brother got me into basketball, you know, just, you know, you're younger, you're following your older brother. He was playing basketball, so, you know, we would go outside and just play basketball in our neighborhood, and then eventually at our community center.
Yeah, yeah.
That was close by our neighborhood as well.
It's Heron Park, right?
Yeah, Heron Park Community Center. Yeah.
Oh, that's dope, bro. So like there's a lot of hoopers that come out of Scarborough. So like how did that community play a role in like shaping your game?
Well, it's like anytime you went somewhere in Scarborough to play basketball, you're always going to play against another good a good player. So,
yeah.
You know, whether it was at the YMCA, whether it was at the community center here in Park, whether it was in the school districts, there's always somebody to play against that would push you and you can see where your game is. So that was the kind of benefit to have guys that can also play at a high level to push you and, you know, be the best player you could be.
100%, bro. Wow, that's dope. So also, you played, was it, Scarborough Blues growing up, right?
Yeah, I played Scarborough Blues for like, I was kind of a late onto the Scarborough Blues scene. I played it for about 5-6 years.
Yeah. So what age did that start?
I started when I was in grade 8, so about 14, I want to say.
14, okay.
Scarborough Blues.
So when did you guys know, like, okay, like, because like, for me, like, I remember I played against you guys maybe like one time, and it was like, our team was good for our age group, but we played up a tournament and it's like, yeah, we got destroyed. So I was like, oh shoot, like this is different. So like, did you guys know like, yo, everyone has a chance to do something great here? Like most of the team, or were you guys just like playing?
Oh, we kind of had an idea because, you know, just in the practices that we had,
they
were such like high level practices. Guys were competing. We had good coaching with Coach Bob. And then we had, when Nick Wiggins joined our team, we had his dad helping coach our team, so that was like another, you know, a former professional just giving us advice and gems all the time and pushing us. So we had a lot. We had David Joseph. We also had Mo Walker's father, Craig. So we had a lot of good coaches around us pushing us. So we knew that, you know, all of us have a chance to do something special with basketball.
So like, what was your like process of getting better? Like, was it like, did you go by yourself? You have a routine? Did someone train you, or did you kind of just figure it out?
Yeah, my process, it kind of started when I was in grade 9.
Yeah.
And I kept it consistent throughout my whole high school career. I would wake up around like 5:30 a.m. every day before school and go to the YMCA. So it's just, I was getting in extra hours every single day. I would probably go from about 6:15 to about 7:45 every day, hour and a half at the Scarborough Y. I would take the bus over there, and then I would take the bus to school, to Mother Teresa. So I'd say my process started in grade 9, and eventually, you know, doing that for a few years, I started to separate myself from the pack. Mm-hmm.
I mean, yeah, that makes sense, like, because a lot of us were playing, and, like, we all really knows what goes into being good,
right.
And it's more so a discipline than a talent thing.
Exactly.
So it kind of makes sense now, because, like, growing up, everybody's just like, okay, that guy's nice, but why? Like, I don't understand it.
Exactly.
So, like, your team had, like, guys like Corey Joseph,
right.
Obviously Mo Walker,
right.
Daniel Mullings.
Yep.
And you guys all went to do, like, big things.
Yep.
So are you guys still close? You guys still talk? Or?
Yeah, we all still talk. All of us still, you know, keep in contact.
Yeah.
Especially, like, you know, when we see each other, it's, of course, it's going to be always love.
Mm-hmm.
You know, growing up with guys and playing basketball with guys, you build a brotherhood and a bond that, you know, that can never be broken. So, you know, it's always good to see those guys and to see how successful they are. Corey being in the NBA, I think he's going into his 10th year.
Mm-hmm.
Mo Walker being a 6-7 year professional. Daniel Mullen, same thing. So it's good to see these guys' success stories, knowing where they came from and how hard they had to work to get to where they are today.
100%, bro. That's dope, man. So, like, the Toronto basketball scene, mm-hmm. like, growing up in that time, like, it's, like, very, very competitive.
Yep.
So how did you guys, like, figure out how to stand out in that time? Like, especially even, like, you and Corey. Like, at that time, it was, like, for me, being a younger kid watching everything, it was, like, Ashton and Corey. That's all I really heard about. So, like, what was that like for you? Did you guys, like, make it a goal to, like, be better than anybody else, or, like?
What we did, kind of, like, we just pushed each other, you know? Growing up, we would play basketball pretty much on the week, because he went to school in Durham. I went mm-hmm. to school in Scarborough. So, you know, every weekend we got, you know, we'd go to the YMCA. He'd come down to the Heron Park Community Center. We would always push each other, a lot of one-on-ones, whether it was in my neighborhood, outside, and just pushing one another to try to be as best as we can.
Mm-hmm.
And then also what helped us joining AAU, you know, AAU also helped because there was a lot of good players on the AAU scene
mm-hmm.
on our teams. And those practices, I remember traveling to Malton Community Center because mm-hmm. I played for CIA Bounce for a bit. And those practices were good. And then going down to Falstaff when I played for Grassroots,
mm-hmm.
there's another group of players that I would play with. And so I'm getting, like, the best of both worlds and getting to compete with the best players in the city. I would say Team Ontario helped that journey
yeah.
as well. Playing with the Ontario team for 3 years. And I played with the U19 Canadian national team for a tournament as well.
That's dope, bro. That's dope, man. So with that said,
mm-hmm.
With things like OBAs
oh, yep.
and OFSA, which were popular at the time.
Yep.
What was it like for you, like, going through those battles? Like,
OBA was great, man. We always went up against, I remember Toronto 5-0 was a big
yeah.
team. Triple Threat was a big team. There was a bunch of team. Brampton A's,
mm-hmm.
Brampton Blue Devils.
Blue Devils,
sorry,
yeah.
Blue Devils. Brampton Blue Devils was,
yeah.
was a tough one. Mississauga Monarchs. So, you know, we always had our battles. Our team was stacked, you know,
mm-hmm.
with Mo and Corey and Wiggins
mm-hmm.
and Panola, Ansel, Mullins. So our team, we had a good team and we had a good coaching staff. So our team was very successful. But yeah, it was definitely a part of the journey, which kind of helped. It kind of helped open your eyes that, okay, you maybe can do something with basketball.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you maybe can go somewhere. I think that OBA's kind of solidified that for us.
Nah, definitely. Definitely, bro. So you playing at Mother Teresa,
mm-hmm.
I kind of gave you a chance to, like, you know, go crazy. I remember Hoop Down GTA was, like,
yep,
really Hoop popular
GTA,
at the time.
Yeah.
Did you feel like when you were playing, was it, like, more so fun or was it pressure? Did you have pressure on yourself? Like,
For me, I was, like, when I first started out, like, because I started playing basketball pretty late, like, when I was in middle school, really.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I was a soccer player to start and I just wanted to have fun. So when I was in grade 9, it was really fun playing on the junior team. We even had, like, a grade 9 team. I was playing with my friends because I went to Mother Teresa, but my home school was West Hill.
Oh, okay.
So I went to Mother Teresa because everyone from my Scarborough Blues team, my OBA team, was going to Mother Teresa. So I was
mm-hmm.
like, and the coach, Coach Bob, was also the coach for the Mother Teresa team. So I was like, okay, it'll be cool to play with my rep team coach and
mm-hmm.
my rep team teammates. So I just wanted to really have fun. And there was a little bit of pressure, but there was a high expectation for me, because when I was going into grade 10, Coach Gallagher decided to only allow me to play on the senior team.
Okay.
Me personally, I want to play on the junior team.
Yeah.
You know, with my friends and people my age. And I knew that if I went to the senior team in grade 10, I had to play with the grade 11s, 12s, mm-hmm. and the fifth years. People I didn't really know, and this older age. Mm-hmm. I mean, it was ended up being beneficial to me. But yeah, Gallagher had me starting, you know, as a grade 10 on the senior team. So there was a little pressure there, like playing with guys that are 2-3 years older than me. I'm about 15, 16. Guys are 18, 19, you know.
Yeah. No, definitely, bro. That was very, very competitive at that time. Mm-hmm. So, like, I mean, like, Toronto is, like, known for that, like, shaping a lot of good players, a lot of guards. The competition is, like, it's at really, really high level. So that makes a lot of sense. Like, what went into you as far as AAU? Like, you said you played for CIA Bounce and Grass, which were the two best teams at the time.
Right.
So what went into you playing AAU? Did you just come upon it, or was it popular, or, like?
I just stumbled upon it, you know, just playing in the rep basketball, mm-hmm. Knowing guys, and then seeing that they're playing AAU, and they're going to get a chance to go to the U.S. and potentially get scouted, and, mm-hmm. you know, because when we were playing back then, you know, it wasn't as easy to get a scholarship or mm-hmm. an offer from Canada as it is today. It's a mm-hmm. little bit easier. There's a lot more opportunities. But then it was, you know, the opportunities were more north of the border. Mm-hmm. So, like, that's when AAU, you know, became a big factor. It was like, okay, maybe we need to go to the U.S. to play some tournaments and to mm-hmm. be seen by colleges.
No, 100%, bro. 100%. So when you went down there, who was, like, some of the best players you guys competed against? Were there any NBA players or?
Yeah, some NBA players. Kyrie Irving, mm-hmm. Joe Jackson. It's a lot of guys, like, a lot of guys over the years. Jared Sullinger mm-hmm. played for Ohio Red. A lot of NBA players we competed against. A lot of high major Division I players. So it was always competitive because we went to the best tournaments.
North yeah.
Carolina, Vegas. So you're going to come across some of the best players in your age group.
Mm-hmm.
You know? So it was always good. It was always good.
Mm-hmm. So, like, you were, like, obviously one of the best guards at that time. And you going to Brewster was, like, no surprise. So, like, did you have any other prep school you wanted to go to, or did you just, like, okay, that's the one?
Honestly, the only other prep school was Finlay Prep.
Yeah.
Because at the time, you know, Corey was going there. So
yeah.
That was the other opportunity. I ended up getting an offer from them to go there, but decided to go to Brewster Academy mm-hmm. with Mo.
Mm-hmm.
Mo, yep.
No, that makes sense. That makes sense. So what was it like playing at Brewster?
Brewster was an eye-opener because, obviously, you know, you're dominating the scene in Toronto,
mm-hmm.
Especially for basketball. And we, you know, we came in second place my last year of high school in
Canada, yeah.
in OFSA. We won a silver, so we were like, well, we still had another year. And a lot of the guys on Eastern that beat us, they were graduating. So we were very confident that we were going to get the gold the following year.
Mm-hmm.
But then Brewster came onto the table, and, you know, we thought, okay, we're going to go there, and it's, you know, we're going to dominate. And we got there, and, you know, first day we got there, there's great players on campus. You know, we had a little scrimmage, and that's when I first met Will Barton.
Mm-hmm.
And he's putting the ball through his legs, windmills, C.J. Fair, who's a four-year
yeah.
graduate from Syracuse.
Yeah.
And, Nadir Tharp, who was a starting point guard yeah. at Kansas. We just had so many players. And I was like, oh, it was a kind of eye-opener.
Mm-hmm.
Like, everybody's really good here,
mm-hmm.
you know. So we had alumni games and people coming back to practice with us. And it was a big eye-opener going yeah. to Brewster.
That's amazing, bro. Mm-hmm. That's a different type of experience.
Yep.
So that was what, the NEPSAC conference, right?
That was the NEPSAC, yeah. And a lot of good players that we played against throughout those times.
Yeah,
too.
No, definitely, bro. So how did that kind of shape you? How did you, like, get ahead on there? Because, like, you're playing with a number of NBA players.
Right. You know, the coach is really good. You know, so he definitely helps prepare guys. You know, Donovan Mitchell went to Brewster Academy. Mm-hmm. TJ Warren. A lot of NBA guys, a lot of high major Division I guys mm-hmm. playing overseas. So the coach has a lot of experience working with guys. So he puts us in position to be successful. His practices are very detailed.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, it's just like a fishbowl when you're there. There's no days off, really, because, you know,
yeah.
Mike Krzyzewski coming in, John Calipari,
wow.
the whole Syracuse staff. Like, you don't know which high major school is going to be in the gym that day. So, you know, there's no real cutting corners. Mm-hmm. You know, you got to bring it every day because there's probably not a practice when there's not a high Division I coach in the building.
Yeah, that's amazing, bro. So, but like, how did you like separate yourself there? Because like, you obviously, you know, you got to compete for playing time.
Right. Yeah.
So like, yeah, everyone's cool, but like, you want to get your looks. You obviously have your goals as well. Right. So how did you find out, like, figure out a way to do that?
Oh, the one thing I think that helped me was just from where I came from, you know, coming from Scarborough, coming from Toronto, you have that grit, you know, mm-hmm. you're going to play hard no matter what. And I brought that with me. And, you know, going to school, Mother Teresa, of course, too, it's a gritty school. Mm-hmm. So I had a foundation of just perseverance and fighting through. The other guard was really good, too, Nadir Tharp, mm-hmm. went to Kansas. We would compete. We're boys up to this day. But, you know, on the court, we were competing in practice because obviously we had to share that point guard position.
Yeah.
But, I mean, it worked out great, you know. Just locking in, you know, being my first time away, being from home was when I went to high mm-hmm. school out there. Got a little homesick. But once I got over that, it was like, yo, we got to lock in. And what helped is I was with Big Mo, too.
Yeah.
We lived together. Me, Big Mo, Will Barton, and CJ Fair, we lived in a house together. So us four sticking together was very, very good for us because it was all four of our times.
Mm-hmm.
All four of us first time being away from home.
Yeah.
So we all okay. got homesick out of time.
So do you think it would have been better for you if you did like 3 years there, or were you like good with the one?
I was good with the one, yeah, because I think that I got everything I needed out of there. We won the national championship, mm-hmm. the state championship, the first Brewster Academy team to do that in history.
Wow.
Our team actually got inducted into Hall of Fame.
That's dope,
in
bro.
In 2019. Yeah.
I seen you. I seen you on Instagram. I think, no, Facebook. You posted it.
Yeah, we got inducted into Hall of Fame because it was the first team to get to win the NEPSAC mm-hmm. championship and the national championship in the same season. They've done it again since, but we were the first ones to kind of do that. So.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that experience was an amazing experience.
That's dope, bro. That's dope. It's priceless. Those experiences priceless. Can't really get back.
Yeah.
And I think that's what separates guys like you from like a lot of other guys, because like, a lot of guys played basketball, but right. not a lot of guys played like that high level, that mm-hmm. the high level. And it's kind of crazy because, you know, playing at Brewster and being like a top player in Canada, everyone was expecting you to go to like a Duke or something, or a Syracuse.
Right.
So I remember you spoke, you had to make some grown man decisions.
Right.
So like, what went into you choosing to go to a college closer to the border rather than one of those high major schools?
Right, yeah. So going to Brewster, you know, I think nine of us went D1. I want to mm-hmm. say nine players got a scholarship, and everyone, you know, went high major. And I had some high major offers as well, you know, having a good season there. I think I hit the game winner in the championship game mm-hmm. for the NEPSAC.
Wow.
We won the national championship, like I said. So everyone was getting big time looks at the time. but right around that time, I would say halfway through my time in high school at Brewster, mm-hmm. I was having my daughter, and she was going to be born in September.
Mm-hmm.
So that would be like the first month of my college freshman year.
Yeah.
So that kind of played a factor in whether I should, you know, just being young at that time, whether I should stay in Canada or still pursue the opportunity to go NCAA Division I. So that kind of played a factor in, okay, maybe I can still go Division I and pursue that,
mm-hmm.
but maybe try to stay as close to the border as possible so I can kind of go back and forth.
Nah, definitely, bro. Definitely. That's dope. And it's honorable because, like, not a lot of guys would do that and make that decision.
Right.
And it's like, it's a big decision because yeah. it shapes the rest of your career, really.
Right, exactly.
Let's say, like, if you would have went to, like, Providence or Virginia Tech.
Exactly.
You might have went to the league.
Right.
And it's like, you know, you got friends who are in the league, and it's like, you were just as good as them, if, you know, not better, arguably, whatever. Does that ever run through your mind, like, yo, if I did this or did that, I would have went to the NBA? Do you have any regrets or, like...
You know, I never had any regrets because before then, I wasn't living for God.
Mm-hmm.
And there was a time where, because of the basketball path I chose, I ended up going to Texas
mm-hmm.
and ended up changing my life around there.
Mm-hmm.
So I think the life change that I made in 2012 to serve God, I could never trade that to go to the NBA or go to a high major Division I.
Mm-hmm.
So that just that reason alone, because I don't know if I would have found God the way I did if I did go to those other schools, because I'm not sure what would have happened in my life or what mm-hmm. doors would have opened or whatever. But with what happened and my college career leading me to Texas for a year and meeting the people I did and making the life changes that I made, I wouldn't change that for the world. I think 2012 was one of the best years of my life to change and head into a more positive direction.
Oh, that's amazing, bro.
Yeah.
So essentially you got saved.
I got saved.
Yeah. No, that's amazing, bro. And it's crazy because, like, one thing, obviously I haven't spoke to you in a while, but like I noticed, like, okay, this guy is not the same person he used to be. It's right. Kind of like a lot different. And that's amazing that, you know, you were able to experience that and, you know, tell people about it now.
Right.
So with that said, bro, what was it like playing college and having a daughter and trying to manage that?
Yeah, that was tough. You know, that was tough because you feel like you're missing out on certain things, but you're trying to do the best you can so you can potentially set her up for a better future. And you know, getting a Division I scholarship or getting any type of education for free is not easy to come by. So you want to kind of take advantage of that opportunity and get that degree for free, you know. So it was just trying to understand that and grasp that while being young, and understanding that what you're doing right now is only temporary and you'll have time, you know, in the future. So it was hard to balance it, but I had good people in my corner, my parents, my family, the pastor that I met in Texas that I still keep in contact with. So with that support system, I was able to, you know, do it with no problem.
Nah, that's amazing, bro. That's actually amazing, man. So what was it like becoming a father? Was it like scary? Was it?
Yeah, that age, you know, it's very nerve-wracking. You're going to think, what's my parents going to think? Stuff like that. But, you know, it was a blessing, you know, very, very happy. And now my daughter's 10 years old now. So, you know, and our relationship is great. So, you know, it helped me mature a little bit as well.
Yeah.
You start looking at things a little different because now you got to provide for another human being, you know. So it was definitely an eye-opener, an opportunity for me to learn and grow and mature and learn from that decision that I made and learn to do and make better decisions in the future.
So like, would you say like that kind of like intensified your work ethic or like it drove you more to be a better basketball player? Like,
Yeah, definitely. I would say it. Not only like basketball, just even like started to go harder in education. Just started to just trying to take things more serious all around. So I just like a whole life change really.
Bro, that's tough, bro. That's tough. So, you know, moving fast forward and from that, from your college now,
right?
You go pro.
Yep.
So what has your overseas experience been like thus far?
It's been great, you know. I started off in the UK. They have a couple leagues out there, first division and a second division. I started off in the first division, the top three team. And I played there for three seasons. I ended up being the captain of the team. At one point. So, I mean, my overseas in Europe particularly was great. I had a great experience there in a few countries. I met some great people, competed. It was good, man. I loved it. And my personal experiences was great.
Yeah, that's amazing, bro. That's amazing. So did you ever get any, like, NBA or G League looks? Did you ever think about pursuing that?
I had my agent talk to me about G League opportunities multiple times.
Yeah.
He said, you know, you can play in the G League. But, you know, I was just having a lot of fun overseas and just enjoying the, I'm a culture guy. I like seeing other countries. I like seeing the way of people, the different way that people think, the different things they value, you know, around the world. You know, I already kind of have an idea of what the North American culture provides and what it represents and their point of views. But it's good to see how people think and how they live in Portugal or France or Spain, or, you know, I was in Asia and Malaysia and China and Japan, and it's just I'm a guy, I want to travel and use the tool to see other people, and not only that, just try to touch lives while I'm out there.
Yeah, 100%, bro. 100%. That's amazing, man. So, like, what is the biggest thing you've learned playing overseas? Like, what would you say? How has that impacted your growth as a person?
You know, you gotta be able to take care of yourself and be self-disciplined. So whether it's waking up on time, taking care of your body, eating right, managing your finances, being able to play under pressure, you know, it's pressure to play overseas. You know, it's not like high school, you know, mm-hmm. where it's all fun and games. Now it's like coaches are looking at the stat sheet, even at halftime, seeing how you're doing. You know, you're not performing 3-4 games in a row. That's a lot of pressure. You know, you could get fired. Mm-hmm. So it's not as, I don't want to say it's not fun, but it's not as, you know, just nonchalant and just hoop. Mm-hmm. You know, you got to bring it. So you got to be disciplined to stay after practice, get to practice early, ice bath, all these things that you didn't really do in high school. Mm-hmm. You got to really take that stuff serious because every practice, every game matters.
No, 100%.
That's the job now, you know?
100%, bro. And it's good that you can kind of shed light on the whole overseas thing because right. like there's this mentality that it's either NBA or nothing, and then like there's a trend now. You see a lot of guys chasing like the lower leagues just to play,
right?
In whether it be in Canada or something like that, and they're not really exploring overseas, understanding like, yo, there's a great lifestyle over there.
Great,
the
yeah.
competition's great, mm-hmm. and you get paid well. Mm-hmm. So, to the kids who like coming up next and they're looking to become a professional, but they may only have the NBA in mind. What advice would you give them?
I would tell them, like, if the NBA doesn't work out right away, you know, Europe, Asia, anywhere overseas is a good option as well. Mm-hmm. There's lots of guys, just off the top of my head, Patrick Beverley. Spent a lot of time in overseas. I think his name, the big man from the Celtics, Thice.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, the starting big man for the Celtics right now, he played like 5-6 years in Germany.
Oh, yeah.
So, like, there, you know, it doesn't matter where you start. It's about where you finish. Mm-hmm. And it's about, you know, honestly, it's just about can you impact others and help the next generation come, you know, yeah. come up. And it's not really, you know, what I tell my friends and stuff, it's not really what you do. It's in terms of, like, your occupation, whether it's basketball or whatever you're doing. But it's whatever you're doing is helping you provide for your family, mm-hmm. take care of your family, and giving you the life that you deserve, you know. So, I mean, whether it's NBA overseas, as long as it's giving you an opportunity to take care of yours and mm-hmm. your family, maybe help your parents or whatever, that's the most important thing, right? So, you know, people want to go NBA, which is, of course, amazing, but it's hard to get into. Mm-hmm. So there's always other options to be a professional.
100%, man. So you were in China this past season, right?
Yeah, two
during
seasons.
The whole pandemic and the political scuffles. Yeah. So like, was it kind of crazy down there during those times?
Yeah, it was like picking, like there was people, like there was talks about certain things when I was there, but fortunately I was going home for Christmas. So I was flying back to go see my wife and spend time with her for Christmas holidays and the New Year's and stuff like that. So when I got back, you know, probably like a week after I got back, I got a phone call saying like there's been an outbreak and mm-hmm. Not to come back.
Yeah.
I was, because I had my flight booked to return, right?
Yeah.
I was just on my holiday vacation. And man, it just, you know, I haven't even gone back since because of everything that's taken place. Mm-hmm. Contract got canceled, the season got canceled, all that stuff.
So aside from that though, like how was the basketball down there in China?
It's great, man. The fans they're so dedicated and passionate, and because the population in China is so many people, you know, there's so many people at the game, you mm-hmm. know, playing in front of thousands and thousands of people at some of these games is a pretty cool atmosphere.
Mm-hmm.
Like you would never think like, oh, you're going to play in such a big atmosphere, you know? So, and our arena was awesome. So it was a great experience, you know. Tough parts, you know, was like the food a little bit was challenging,
yeah.
like some of the food, and you know, just my coach didn't speak any English, he only spoke Mandarin.
Wow.
So I had to start picking up on Mandarin, taking lessons.
That's
now.
Oh wow, yeah, that's nuts, bro. Is that like the same league as like Stephon Marbury?
No, there's another league out there in the Anhui province. There's a league out there, yeah. So it was good.
Nah, that's dope, man. That's dope, bro. So like I see a lot of guys now, they're struggling to transition outside
right.
of basketball.
Right.
And adjusting to life after basketball.
Mm-hmm.
So do you kind of have like a plan? Do you know how much longer you want to play? Like, what does that look like for you?
For me, you know, just whatever makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
You know, whatever makes sense. You know, I always tell guys, and especially some of my friends that are playing professional now that are coming down to maybe their knees aren't feeling the way they used to, or they, you know, they're looking to retire. It's like, use basketball, like the season that you're in, as like, you know, a crutch, And while you're playing that season, start looking for other opportunities. Start mm-hmm. networking. Start talking to people back at your university. Start seeing what other businesses you can do. So like, yeah, you're still playing, right? You're still playing, mm-hmm. but as you're playing, you're still figuring out your next move. Because that's mm-hmm. what I do when I play. You know, when I was playing in the UK, I had camps. I had my own after school programs.
Wow.
I was doing a lot of different stuff outside of just, you know, only just playing basketball. Mm-hmm. When I was in China, I started a whole basketball program, a training program. And I mean, I haven't been back to China in months, but that training program's still running.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, and I started that like a year ago, and it's still, you know, it's still successful today. So it's like, use the platform that you have to run things and start things, because you never know when basketball, you know, can end.
Yeah, that's amazing, bro. So you're kind of like, you kind of like touched everything.
Right.
To see.
To take advantage of every opportunity and blessings I had. Mm-hmm.
So was that like, so obviously you're in business.
Yeah.
Did you go to school for business, like, or like what drove this?
No, I didn't go to school for business. I'm a psychology graduate in psychology, but it's always been an interest of mine, and my brother's in business, so that kind of rubbed off on me, and kind of made sense to start my own business. So I have a couple things that I do.
Mm-hmm. So you're an entrepreneur after this, after
right.
basketball.
Yes.
Which is dope. So do you see yourself, would you ever see yourself coaching or anything like that?
Yeah, I can see myself maybe coaching, depends yeah. on the situation. But yeah, you know, for me, my gift is teaching regardless.
Yeah.
So like, that's my gift that I got from the Lord, is just being
yeah.
a teacher. Doesn't mean that I'm teaching subjects or whatever, but just whatever knowledge that I have and wisdom that I have is I can share to others. And,
mm-hmm.
I'm always want to be a learner as well.
Mm-hmm. No, that's amazing, bro. That's amazing.
Sir.
Nah, so yo, bro, appreciate you coming out today, bro.
Got you, bro.
It's a really good interview, man.
We're done?
Yeah, a lot of people learn from this.
Okay, gotcha. I take my legs down, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh.
I don't know. I know you're sore up there, bro.
Yeah, legs, bro. Legs are working out.